Hey friends, it's Mike Williams. In this video, I want to cover a few items which I thought might be of interest to my audience. The first item is an email I received from a person who has communicated with me over the past couple of years. After watching my 4.5 hour presentation, "Did the Beatles Write All Their Own Music?", this person wrote me to reveal another prominent drummer who drummed on Beatles songs. So in a moment, I will read the email and reveal who that drummer is. Then I will present two session guitarists who I think might be likely candidates to have recorded on Beatle records. So with that, let's move to the email. Hi, Mike. Since more ghosts have come out of the cupboard, my father was a jazz musician playing alto sax, clarinet, and flute. He could also tickle the keyboard. In session work, he played in a studio environment with many stars of years gone by and worked on many film scores. He started off working with the Eric Winstone Big Band and also Ted Heath. All his friends were in music. Ronnie Verrell was a very close friend. Ronnie was also Animal in the Muppets and was hired by many groups as a session drummer, including the Beatles. Like so many others, I liked the Beatles when I was younger, but was always told by my father that they were just a prefabricated band who could do the job on stage, but nowhere else. My father would tell me that Ringo was a very poor drummer and could never nail a song in the studio, whereas Ronnie would have the drum parts nailed by mid-afternoon, just in time for a pint and a cheese roll. There were even days when Ringo was absent from the job and the studio. My father hated the Beatles. Looking back now, I think he knew exactly what was going on. I wish these guys were still with us. Gregory Martin, George Martin's son, will also know the score. Gregory holds many secrets, and the interviews between Howard Goodall and George Martin was cringeworthy. Quincy Jones was correct. My dad liked Quincy because of the studio work and love of jazz. And that concludes the email. So let's learn a little more about Ronnie Verrell. He was born on February 21st, 1926, and died on February 22nd, 2002, at the age of 76. He was an English jazz drummer. He played in two of the United Kingdom's most famous big bands, the Ted Heath Orchestra and the Sid Lawrence Orchestra. Ronnie provided the drumming for the Muppet Show's Animal. The Scotsman called Verrell a driving band drummer and an exciting soloist. The Daily Telegraph said Verrell had a rare combination of craftsmanship and bravura showmanship and called him Britain's best-known big band drummer for half a century. After leaving Heath's band, Verrell focused on session work and backed many popular artists, including Winifred Atwell, Jack Jones, Tony Bennett, Tom Jones, Shirley Bassey, Petula Clark, and the Straubs. In 2000, Verrell toured with an all-star band, Best of British, where his drum solos earned him standing ovations. Now here's a clip of Ronnie playing with the Ian James Big Band from 1999, when Ronnie was 73 years old. Let's take a listen. Thank you. That was an impressive performance by Ronnie, and again, he was 73 at the time. So now we have three session drummers who drummed on Beatles songs. We have Andy White, which the official narrative tells us drummed on the 1962 UK single Love Me Do and P.S. I Love You. We have Bernard Purdy, who went public starting in the 1970s, stating he drummed on 21 Beatles songs from the early albums. Bernard has stuck to his story, and with his 2014 book, Let the Drums Speak, he included a chapter dedicated to the Ringo Starr controversy. And now, a source of mine, who was very close to Ronnie Verrell, tells us Ronnie also drummed on Beatle recordings. Now let's take a moment and revisit a clip I included in my 4.5-hour presentation, Did the Beatles Write All Their Own Music? This is from the DVD titled Produced by George Martin. And in this clip, we have Billy, a.k.a. Paul McCartney, talking with George Martin as they discuss Ringo's drumming and his challenges with keeping precision time behind the drum kit, cluing us in on the real reason as to why Andy White was hired.
Because nobody told me that, you know, when they walked in, this fella came in, this little chap, and I said, "Is our drummer?" I said, "No, he's not. That's your drummer. We're paying good money for that fella." And, you know, we had the best drummer you get in
Andy
the
White,
yeah,
who will never live it down.
I didn't realise until quite late on how much I hurt him by that. And I didn't mean to.
Well, he's a sensitive soul, Ringo. Yeah, yeah. He is a sensitive kind of guy, you know, and I don't think we realised how much that hurt him.
Yeah.
But he got over it. No, you know, he was not precise, and so I think you were used to working with session drummers who were on the ball. And what happened in the Beatles, you know, when we played live, if Ringo sped up a tiny bit, we all just went with him. So nobody really noticed it.
Back on May 4th, 2020, Ringo posted this very peculiar tweet on the Beatles' Twitter site where he says, "The drumming on Rain stands out for me because I feel as though that was someone else playing. I was possessed." The question I would ask is, was he possessed or masterfully speaking and telling us he was not the drummer on Rain? I posted an image of this tweet on my YouTube community page, and one of my subscribers, who is a professional musician, left this comment. He wasn't possessed. His drumming was replaced by Bernard Purdy. We know the deal. Purdy did, in fact, play on way more than 21 tracks. I'm a professional musician. I can tell the difference between styles of playing, and I do hear Bernard Purdy's style on the drumming of Rain. But now that we know about Ronnie Verrell, perhaps it was Ronnie. I'll leave it there and let you decide. Now let's take a look at possible guitarists who may have played on Beatle tracks.
Oh, this is your guitar?
Yes.
Okay.
It's a 1961 Fender Stratocaster.
That's a big wow factor right there.
It certainly is, yeah.
My earliest memories of, you know, when I was a kid, you know, watching old videos of Jimi Hendrix play a white early 60s Stratocaster, but
that's
he
right.
played it upside down.
It did, yeah.
It's in pretty damn good shape. So where did you get this thing?
This guitar's been with me for years. I've worked on records with Nancy Sinatra and Petula Clark, Tom Jones. It's not unusual.
All right. So were you like a studio musician?
I was, from 1958 till about 1983.
Did you play with any rock bands and stuff too?
I did. Well, I mean, I was part of the of Herman's Hermits.
Yeah, I've heard of Herman's Hermits.
Yeah, okay, with the Silhouette. If you hear the Silhouette, that's me playing the solo. I actually worked a little bit with the Beatles. You probably might have heard of the film Hard Day's Night.
Yeah.
Well, when Ringo's walking around at the end of that film, this guitar is playing Ringo's theme, which is the one he's walking about to. So it does have quite a good history.
It's got a hell of a history on it, yeah.
I have a partial list of the records that I played on. This is 36 pages.
This is how many albums you've been on?
Well, albums and films and...
This is your name right here, Vic Flick?
Vic Flick, that's my name, yeah.
Worked on films too?
I worked on films. I worked on Goldfinger, James Bond. Actually played the James Bond theme, which...
You played the James Bond theme?
Yes.
Of all the movie themes, that would probably be the most recognizable one, period. A 1961 Fender Strat is worth 5 digits at least. They're extremely desired. And one that actually played on big movie scores could be worth 10 times that amount. But it's all whether or not the story checks out. So, how much are you looking to get out of it?
$70,000.
Ooh, it's a 61 Strat, so that makes it worth five figures. I mean, the low five figures by itself. I'm gonna call someone up who knows everything about guitar, knows everything in the world about music. I'm just basically gonna ask him, does your name make it worth that much?
Oh, I see.
Okay, so Jesse's store is just a few blocks away, so he'll be down a little bit.
Okay,
all right?
Sure,
right
no
back.
Problem, no problem. I'm used to people not knowing who I am. I have to ask myself that sometimes.
So you know this guy?
Yeah, this is the guy that Jimmy Page would look over his shoulder in the studio and like figure out what he was doing so he could, honor to meet you, honor
well,
to meet you.
Thank you, Jesse.
You helped teach Jimmy Page.
I helped Jimmy Page. I advised him on a couple of things, yes.
You know, I was pretty stoked when they called and told me that Vic Flick was in the shop. One of my heroes from the 60s and 70s. There's very few songs that he didn't play some guitar on.
So I basically need to know, this being his guitar, obviously a very influential guy in the music industry. So what do you think it's worth?
You know, a really good condition 61 in Olympic white. Probably be about a $35,000 guitar on its own.
Okay.
Let alone with the pedigree of this guitar. You've heard this guitar probably more times than you even realize. You've heard this particular guitar.
Probably true, yeah.
Yeah. I could see this going to a collector at auction easily. Easily $60,000-$70,000. This is cool. This is like beyond cool.
Okay, well, thanks a lot, man.
No problem.
If you say it's cool, you say it's cool.
Yeah, that's a good one. All right.
Thank you.
Pleasure meeting you. As far as selling the guitar, I'm sure there's plenty of collectors out there who would love to own that guitar. I mean, not just simply because it was Vic Flick's, but because of the number of songs and recordings that the guitar was used on. It's pretty significant in rock and roll history.
So who is Vic Flick? Vic was born on May 14th, 1937, and is an English guitarist. Flick was a session player featured on many early 1960s UK pop records. He is best known for playing the guitar riff in the James Bond theme. Flick was a member of the George Martin Orchestra. He contributed to the soundtrack of the film A Hard Day's Night, playing his Olympic White 1961 Fender Stratocaster on the instrumental of Ringo's theme. George Martin again recruited Vic Flick and most of the original Goldfinger musicians to provide James Bond-sounding music for the soundtrack of the Beatles movie Help. He worked with many popular artists, including Herman's Hermits, Nancy Sinatra, Dusty Springfield, Tom Jones, Cliff Richard, Paul McCartney, Engelbert Humperdinck, Lulu, Shirley Bassey, Burt Bacharach, Petula Clark, Sandy Shaw, Crispian St. Peters, Hank Marvin, Eric Clapton, Jimmy Page, John Williams, Mark Wirtz, John Schroeder, Don Partridge, Typically Tropical, and Don Lusher. So as we can see, Vic has quite a resume, and it's very interesting to me that Mr. Flick ran in the same circles as George Martin. Considering the quality of guitar playing on the early Beatle records up through Revolver, playing that, in my opinion, was above the play grade of any of the Beatles, it would seem logical to consider Vic as one of the session musicians George Martin hired to play on Beatle records. Now let's move to another possible candidate, someone everyone will know.
You're a teenager, and you're obviously very good because you're an in-demand session musician, which...
Yeah.
And there was a lot of kids around at that time who were good, so you must have been the exception.
There was other people that were good, but I got the opportunity to sort of walk through that sort of... ironclad door of the session musicians, a very extremely closed shop, and I was given a a tryout, you know, to on sessions with other studio musicians. And I must have been 7 years younger than anybody else that was around at that point. And some are considerably older, you know. But I obviously managed to. They'd asked me to just make up what I. You know, they said, well, you can make up a part for that, play what you want. And because I had these sort of roots across the board, going through sort of from sort of rockabilly but rock, but then also through Chicago blues and the whole Chess catalogue, Howling Wolf, the whole works, and then acoustic playing as well. I played harmonica too, like what other people were doing at the time. I became quite an in-demand session player, on these, one instrument or the other.
The sessions that you played on, I mean, there's a list here: Kinks, Who, Rolling Stones, Dusty Springfield, and Benny Hill.
Yes.
A Benny Hill session. What on earth, which record was that? You remember?
Well, it wasn't Ernie the Fast.
No, that's that.
But it could have been. I know that I played on. It was in the same studio that like Downtown was done in.
Petula Clark.
Yeah, and all of those. Don't sleep.
That Regent. That wasn't Regent Sound, was it?
No, yeah. It's Pi Studios. Okay. It doesn't exist anymore. Right, it's at Marble Arch. I was just going to chat it in there, and I was like, the guitarist playing along to his sort of things, you know, because he used to write these things with about three chords, which suited me, all right?
God love him.
Three chords.
God love him.
But all the sort of comedy albums that he did with songs, and
you
might have been on Ernie, but
you can't remember. You've been on that many sessions.
Do you know what? It's absolutely true.
I love.
Do you know somebody? Came to me. They did an interview with me yesterday. And they had an album which is the equivalent of like Two Yanks in Britain, and it's the Everly Brothers. And I looked at it, and I knew what it was. I sort of remembered it along the past, and it was done involving members of the Hollies,
Graham
Nash, Decca Studios, way back with the Everly Brothers.
They hung outside.
And he gave me a copy, a vinyl copy, and I was thrilled to bits.
Nice,
you know?
Nice. Also, you've done
but
so many.
You forget things. You can't remember everything. Names of the titles of the thing, but I knew I did the sessions.
You could be doing 10 sessions a day, so you're not expected to remember.
Well, I was doing three sessions a day. Yeah. That's a lot in three different locations.
Goldfinger, Shirley Bassey, you're on that.
Yes, I was on that.
Wow.
Yeah.
Incredible. I mean, you were so lucky to fall in. I'm not saying this is nothing to deny you.
You're falling in by now.
It was just like, wow.
It didn't take very long before I was really firmly established within this. Wow,
these are great tracks, though.
Oh, my goodness gracious, yeah. And
really great tracks. Yeah.
Many people only know Jimmy Page as the guitarist for Led Zeppelin, but his resume is extensive, especially as a session musician. James Patrick Page, OBE, born January 9, 1944, is an English musician, songwriter, multi-instrumentalist, and record producer who achieved international success as the guitarist and founder of the rock band Led Zeppelin. Page began his career as a studio session musician in London, and by the mid-1960s, alongside Big Jim Sullivan, was one of the most sought-after session guitarists in Britain. He was a member of the Yardbirds from 1966 to 1968. Mike Leander of Decca Records first offered Page regular studio work, and it should be noted that Mike Leander did the arrangement for the Beatles song She's Leaving Home. Page contributed guitar to the incidental music of the Beatles' 1964 film A Hard Day's Night, which was recorded at Abbey Road Studios. He was a session musician on the Goldfinger soundtrack along with John Paul Jones and Vic Flick, which was produced by George Martin. He played on records for The Kinks, The Who, Marianne Faithfull, Van Morrison, and many more artists. We can see there is a tight inner circle that all of these studio and session musicians operate within. With Page, we have ties back to George Martin, Vic Flick, and The Beatles via his playing on the Hard Day's Night soundtrack. Jimmy's acoustic guitar playing is exceptional, and it is not beyond the realm of possibility that he too was hired by George Martin to record on Beatle tracks. In a moment, I will play an old clip I found of Jimmy Page being interviewed in 1963 at the age of 19 about being a session musician. As you're listening, think to yourself, how is it did a 19-year-old come to be interviewed about session work, and more importantly, how was he able to break into the business at the age of 17? A business that was comprised of much older musicians with decades more experience than Page. Obviously, he was talented, but perhaps grooming was involved. In other words, did Jimmy Page have his music career launched and steered by people within the pyramid who selected the Led Zeppelin guitarist early in life to gradually evolve into one of the giants of rock music in order to push their Aquarian agenda forward, in order to dramatically transform our social and cultural mindset? This is a possibility, given the ongoing influence of Page and Led Zeppelin on the minds of the youth and society, starting with the release of their first album back in 1969. Now let's take a listen to the interview from 1963.
Jimmy Page, what is a session guitarist? It's a guitarist who's called in to make records, not necessarily doing one-night stands, hoping that they'll get into the hit parade, but only getting an ordinary fee.
It doesn't work for any particular singer all the time. It's different singers.
Not necessarily. Not necessarily.
I gather there are only a few young session guitarists like yourself. Why is this?
Well, it seems to be quite a closed shop. The musicians' union sort of have their own chaps in, and they don't really like to get the young people in because the old boys need the work.
So how did you become a session guitarist?
I don't know. Perhaps they thought I had the feel for it.
How long have you been playing the guitar?
4 years.
Have you always been a session guitarist?
No. No, only in the last 18 months.
Do you play for a regular group yourself?
Yes, Neil Christian and the Crusaders.
And what sort of things do you do with this group?
Well, we do one-night stands all over England, most of the country.
What are the big names that you have backed on this?
Jed Harris and Tony Meehan, Eden Kane, Duffy Power.
What is it like working with some of the really big names of show business?
Disappointing.
Why is that?
Well, they don't come up to how you expect them to be. Rather disappointing on the whole, I would say.
See, well, that's probably bad news for some record fans. What's your personal or your professional ambition? Is it to be a guitarist all the time? Do you want to make your own record?
No, not necessarily. I'm very interested in art. I think I'd like to become an accomplished artist.
Rather than the guitarist?
Yes, possibly.
Is this a means to an end for you? Are you hoping to earn enough money through your guitar playing?
Yes, yes. I'm hoping to finance my art by the guitar.
Well, friends, that concludes this video, which took on a life of its own, and I hope you enjoyed it. There are three documentaries I highly recommend if you would like to understand how the music industry really works. The first is The Wrecking Crew, which reveals who was playing on all those pop records in the 1960s and 70s we all enjoyed. The link to the documentary is in the description box below. The second video is Hired Gun, which picks up where The Wrecking Crew left off, taking us into the modern era of music. And the third is a documentary titled Corporate FM, which explains how radio stations went from independent entities to corporate-controlled playlists. Hired Gun and Corporate FM can be found on Amazon Prime Video. Thanks for listening, and take care.